So we move from virology to immunology, and it gives me great pleasure to announce Adam Gehring, well known. He's actually the organizer of this international HBV meeting. Thanks so much for doing that, Adam.
Thank you.
And he's likely well known to you, has worked in London, in Singapore, in St. Louis, and now in Toronto. And the title of his talk is Combination of Compounds That Stimulate and Enhance Function of HBV-Specific B and T Cells.
Thank you, Harry. Good day, everyone. So for my talk today, I'm largely going to focus on concepts around this and present only a tiny bit of data, because the fact is most of these immunological drugs don't have robust phase two clinical trial data or published data especially. So because I am talking about some drugs, these are my disclosures. And so Haitao sort of touched on all these, but I would say one of the fantastic things that we've seen over the past number of years is an expansion of these direct antiviral targets. And you can really follow these around the viral life cycle of the cell, from entry to interference, blocking encapsidation, blocking reverse transcription. And I think Haitao pointed out very nicely, the big issue here is the cccDNA degradation and how we're going to get to targeting that. And so while there has been an expansion of these direct-acting antivirals, one of the real issues is that these direct-acting antivirals, they block intermediate steps in viral replication. And so when you don't eliminate the viral template and you stop this, the virus comes back. And so this is an example of patients that are on long-term nucleoside analog treatment. In this case, this is the patient we followed in one study. It was 4 years on nucleoside analog treatment, and as soon as they stop, within about 6 to 8 weeks, this viral rebound and the black line happens, and then liver damage can follow shortly after with potentially severe side effects. And this is just recent data from EASL that was presented. These capsid assembly modulators, these patients could be on this for a very long time, more than 1 year, and as soon as they stop, within 4 weeks, the virus comes back into the circulation. And so these are the small molecule drugs, but the situation is not, I would say, not similar, but it also happens with the new drugs, the RNAi interference drugs. And so these are four different examples of compounds that have been presented, where you can see in each case these siRNAs will drive down antigen in the circulation very nicely, so it's very exciting. And they all rebound. The rebound is slow, but it's definitely coming back in all cases. So really, that shows us that the barrier to functional cure is really eliminating the cccDNA. It's long half-life, it's replenished, and it's not targeted by these nucleoside, the direct-acting antivirals. And there's also this aspect of hepatitis B surface antigen being produced from integrated HBV DNA. But we know that the immune system can actually target and eliminate these infected cells, even cells expressing the integrated HBV DNA producing the S antigen only. And so I would say the benchmark for most immunotherapies is to get the immune system back to what we consider resolution of acute infection. I mean, I think there's some caveats related to this that I don't have time to go into today, but it seems a reasonable approach. And when we think about the immune system, there's two different branches. You have innate immunity, which acts and responds very quickly to viral infection, produces interferons, and then you have adaptive immunity, T and B cells, which expand later and then specifically target infected cells and antigen. And so I'm going to start with innate immunity. And we know that there are particular innate cytokines that display direct acting antiviral function. And the most well-known of these is interferon alpha, because it's been developed for therapy. But there are also other cytokines that will do this. And you know, this study is 16 years old now, but it was done in the HBV transgenic mouse. And it gives us really nice insight that activating the innate immune system can lead to a clearance of HBV RNA species in the mouse liver. So just injecting these drugs that target different receptors on innate cells induces cytokines that clear the virus, and this is mostly related to interferon alpha in the mouse model. And so within this concept, these are just a couple of the drugs that have been through phase 2 clinical trials that developed to target these TLR agonists. In this case, it's selgantolimod, which is a TLR8 agonist. And this has been recently through a phase 2 clinical study. And I'm not going to show all the immunological data behind this, but they did show target engagement by induction of these cytokines. They could be measured in the plasma. But the fact is, there are four lines here, and you'd never know that because they're completely overlapping, and there was no direct antiviral effect on the HBV DNA, which is contrary to what we saw in the mouse model. There was another drug also developed to target a different receptor, TLR7. And in this case, the main target was to induce interferon alpha production. And this data has been published. It's also been presented in a number of abstracts. You can see target engagement, mechanism of action, but again, no impact on the hepatitis B surface antigen. So even though they worked well in the animal models, they didn't work great in the patients, but they were safe, and they actually engaged their target. We could measure that by measuring the immune responses. So I'm going to switch then to the adaptive immunity. And we know in terms of a T-cell response from studying patients, from studying animal models, what's important. So we know it has to be a coordinated response. CD4 cells, CD8 T-cells, the B-cells, they all work in concert together to do different jobs. The CD4 T-cells help the B-cells make the antibodies prevent infection, the CD8 T-cells eliminate the infected hepatocytes. And when you measure the T-cell response in a patient that has an acute or resolved infection, what you see is each of these bars represents a T-cell response. And so there's lots of different bars across the whole viral proteins. And that's what we would call robust or multispecific response. When you do the exact same experiment in patients with chronic infection, your plate is almost blank. You don't see any T-cell responses. And I'm not going to go into this data, but there's been a huge amount of work done to really characterize the level of exhaustion. So these T-cells just don't perform as well in the chronically infected patients because of a number of issues that I'm going to get into in the following slides. So the goal has been really to try, how can we boost these adaptive immune responses? How can we boost T-cell responses? And how can we boost B-cell responses? And so the most logical approach, at least being an immunologist, is therapeutic vaccines. And this review, I published part of this, it was a few years ago now, but there's been many, many trials in the past trying to use therapeutic vaccines to induce T-cell and B-cell immunity. And you can see many of these are using recombinant antigens or, at the time, DNA vaccines with some other modalities used here. And so one of the things, or some of the observations from these studies was that some could induce T-cell immunity, some didn't measure this in the studies. Others could induce the production of anti-HBs antibodies, which we consider to be a marker of seroprotection, but they actually didn't eliminate the virus. And the fact is none of these earlier studies had a significant impact on HBV replication. And there's some obvious potential caveats to some of these responses. I mean, one is a misdirected immune response. You have the contents of a vaccine may not match the virus in the patient. I think this is less likely because there is a lot of cross-reactivity. The stimulation is too weak, and I think this is probably the biggest one. Using recombinant antigen, I'm going to give you an example of this, is going to be a big challenge when it comes to these hepatitis B patients because of the viral load, because of the S antigen that's present. And really, I don't think they were effectively combined with antiviral therapy because these early studies used just a few months of nucleoside analog treatment. They weren't on long-term treatment. They didn't have the other DAAs that we have now that can really have a significant impact on the viral replication cycle. And so the exciting thing is, and this has taken a few years to get here, is that now we have really, I would say, an impressive array of potential modes of action for therapeutic vaccines coming down that are way more immunogenic, are way stronger. And so, taking a DNA vaccine and mixing it with electroporation, there's vaccines that are going to use two different modes to deliver the boost to the immune system with antigen and viral vectors. There's new technologies related to peptides that make them more immunogenic. They can really specifically target epitopes. And then there are the viral vector-based vaccines. So the adenovirus has been used by J&J and AstraZeneca now for the COVID vaccines. They're highly immunogenic. They really stimulate a good T-cell response, and you could put multiple antigens in them. And earlier on in the stages right now are arena viruses. These are being developed. They're very similar. They're a viral vector that deliver the antigens in a very immunogenic way to stimulate a T-cell response. So I think we have a good opportunity to really boost the T-cell responses very strongly. But here's the concept I was talking about. Even though you boost the T-cell responses, you still have to overcome multiple layers of suppression to really to support that response at the site of infection in the liver. And so when you get to the liver, there's no shortage of factors here. As I said, we have a high antigen burden, and this is just an example here. I'm just going to do a little bit of math. Each of us has about 5,000 milliliters of blood. 55% of our blood is serum, and if a patient has 5,000 international units of S antigen per mil of serum, That's 68 milligrams of S antigen just in the circulation, not even accounting for the antigen that's in the blood. And most of those vaccines in the past use 10 micrograms to 50 micrograms of antigen to boost the immune response. That's a thousandfold difference. There's a thousandfold more viral antigen in the circulation than the antigen you put in somebody's arm. So that antigen has to look different, right? So, and that's what the new vectors are trying to do. But there's also now the potential to reduce antigen in the circulation. And this was touched upon by Haitao, looking at siRNAs, antisense oligos, these translation inhibitors, and NAPs. But these don't come with caveats either. The concept is nice, you get rid of it. But this is a study that we're actually, we've done in my lab now, and it's submitted for review. We use these siRNAs in vitro in infected cells, and you can see very nicely that this combination of siRNAs will reduce the HBV replication. And here, the core antigen is seen, it's a bit difficult, but in the siRNA treated, the core antigen is decreased over time out to 10 days with these siRNA drugs. And so that is doing its mechanism of action. But the fact is, when you reduce the antigen in the infected hepatocytes, you reduce the ability of the immune system by 80% to see those hepatocytes. So if the hepatocyte is infected, the immune response is here at 100%. If you use the siRNA drugs, the T cells can't recognize the infected hepatocytes. So this comes into concepts around timing when you want to combine these therapies. The other ones are inhibitory receptors. So in the liver, there's a lot of inhibitory receptors, and the main ones that have been characterized are this PD-1, PD-L1 axis. And as a result of that, there's a number of drugs that have been developed or being developed and are coming into phase one for hepatitis B to address this. Antibodies to PD-1 or PD-L1, PD-L1 small molecules, or again, antisense oligos that knock down PD-L1. So this is a nice idea that takes the brakes off the immune system. But here, at least in our in vitro assays where we're measuring the immune response in context of this checkpoint blockade or PD-1 blockade, what we find is only a fraction of the patients will respond. And so this is a study that we're also doing currently, looking across the different phases of hepatitis B and see who responds to anti-PD-1 therapy ex vivo by boosting a T cell response. And so some categories of patients don't really respond very well to PD-1 blocking, and then even in those patients, in those categories of patients that do respond, not all patients respond. So that's the T-cell response, and there was evidence now that blocking these PD-1, PD-L1 interaction can also enhance the B-cell responses. And so this is a similar situation where you block the B-cell, you block the checkpoints, and you get more antibodies or more B-cells producing antibodies to the hepatitis B surface antigen. And these are the chronic hepatitis B patients. They can also see an effect in these healthy vaccinated controls. But if you look, the scales are different. So again, the B cells in hepatitis B patients are weaker. And we have limited data so far. This needs to be expanded, I think, a little bit more before we can truly say that this will be a big boost. And of course, with these, you're taking breaks off the immune system. So there is a concern related around safety and these immune-related adverse events that happen. And so biomarkers to stratify patients who will respond to maximize efficacy. And that's one of the reasons we undertook this study, is to try and identify if we could pick those patients out. And I think there's really some exciting opportunities around modulating the microbiome to promote response to this. And this is being done in the cancer field as well. It's not clear how it works yet, but it definitely has an impact on how these checkpoint blockade drugs work. So then coming back to sort of the last layer in the liver, particularly in a quiescent state, is a very suppressive environment. You have suppressive factors like arginase, which degrade essential amino acids the immune response needs, and regulatory cytokines like IL-10 and TGF-beta. And so this is where I think the innate immunomodulators can come back into play, because these TLR agonists, they stimulate antiviral and T-cell supporting cytokines. So when we stimulate, these are just commercially available agonists that we bought from suppliers, but when you stimulate your immune system with these TLR7 or TLR8 agonists, of course you see interferon alpha produce, interferon beta, you get interferon gamma, and a number of other things like IL-12, which also supports T-cell responses. So these drugs can stimulate these, and we knew that their mechanism of action worked in the patients. They didn't have a direct antiviral effect. But a secondary effect of these drugs, because you're producing interferon alpha and interferon gamma, they enhance antigen presentation. And enhancing antigen presentation makes the cells more visible to the immune system. And so without these drugs, you see very little T cell response to infected hepatocytes. But when you take the supernatants from these cells here where they have the interferons, this presentation to T cells and T cell activation goes up dramatically. And this is true for different types of antigens. So for the surface antigen, for the core antigen, and the TLR agonists themselves had no effect on these cells if they weren't infected. So I think this is an exciting secondary mode of action. So then I'm gonna conclude, and then I'm gonna give you my combination strategy. So far, there's no evidence that a monotherapy is going to lead to functional cure. We have a number of direct-acting antivirals, and all of these are effective when looking at their specific biomarkers, but we haven't seen an effect on cccDNA. We have now a number of different immunotherapies coming down the pipeline, innate immunomodulators, therapeutic vaccines, checkpoint blockade, and recently anti-HBs antibodies. We saw a little bit here at the meeting about these. So in my, maybe a bit provocative, but most DAAs are unlikely to have an additive benefit for combination therapy with immunotherapies, because most of the same nucleoside analogs, whether they will reverse and reduce HBV DNA production in the circulation, but they don't actually change the antigen or have an impact on the immune response. So what do I think is going to be an effective immunotherapy? I have two potential combinations. So one is a fully immune combination in this strategy. So a vaccine, a therapeutic vaccine, plus an innate immunomodulator. And the concept here is to get that antigen in, wake up the immune system in the periphery, use an orally derived immunomodulator that's going to stimulate those cytokines, change the environment in the liver, and pull those T cells into the liver. So it's likely to make the liver environment more amenable to T cell function. But you're combining two innate immunomodulators, so there is some concern, but this is the kind of strategy that I could see with, you know, a vaccine schedule on top of, say, I think so far the immunomodulators have been weekly dosing, essentially, and then follow this out for follow-up. I think the other logical combination is an RNAi plus a vaccine, and then plus or minus an innate immunomodulator, and this is no nucleoside backbone here. And here, you would have to lead in with the RNAi, maybe 6 months of lead-in. And then as that antigen, as I showed, as it starts to return, that's when you could come in with a therapeutic vaccine to boost the T cell response when there's something to recognize in the liver. So I will stop there because I can see I'm a minute over, and I'm looking forward to taking any questions during this discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Adam.